What's up, guys? Dr. Sangeeta here for another lecture of Dental Pathshala. Thank you all who have subscribed to Dental Pathshala. So today we'll be discussing stenar analysis. Last video we have studied the Down's analysis, which had 10 parameters. Out of that, 5 are skeletal parameter, 5 are dental parameters. Same, the stenar analysis also has 5 skeletal parameter, 5 dental parameter, also additional parameter, which is a soft tissue analysis, which is in case of a stenar analysis. So let's get started. Developed this analysis in 1930 with the idea of using minimal number of measurements. You have studied Down's analysis in the previous video. There were a lot of calculations, lot of numerical value. So Stenar used least number of measurements and provided a maximum number of clinical information out of these angles. So stenar analysis is divided into 3 parts. The first one is the skeletal parameter. The second one is the dental parameter. And there is one more parameter in stenar analysis, which is the soft tissue analysis. So let's study one by one. The skeletal analysis, it has 5 angles. The first one is SNA, SNB, ANB, mandibular plane angle. This angle was there in the Down's analysis as well, and the occlusion plane angle. These 2 angles we have already studied in the Down's analysis, but in stenar analysis these angles are different. The angle which are measured, they have used the different planes for this. So the first one is our SNA angle. Break the term, as I have been telling you, break the term to get the whole idea about it. So SNA angle, it is an angle which is formed by joining these 3 points. You don't have to memorize it. It is already there in the term itself. So break the term. The first point is our S point, which is the midpoint, that is our sella turcica. Midpoint of the sella turcica is our S point. We have studied in the anatomical landmarks. The another one is the anterior part on the frontonasal suture, which is our nasion point, and A is our subspinal. So we connect all these 3 lines, S to N to A, S, N and A. So this angle which is formed by joining, which is formed by intersecting the SN plane and a line which connects point N, which is our nasion, to our subspinal point A. So this angle gives an idea of anterior posterior positioning of the maxilla in relation to the cranial base. So this is given relationship of the maxilla, since this A point is in the maxilla. So this mean value for this angle is 82 degrees, which is a frequently question asked in NEET exam. The value is 82 degrees. Now this value increases if this point, this angle will increase if the A point is shifted ahead of this. Now, for example, in case of a prognathic maxilla, in case of a skeletal class 2 malocclusion, the point A is going to be somewhere ahead from this point. So imagine this is a class 2 malocclusion and this is our central incisor. So this point is going to be somewhere here. So this angle is increased by this much. So SNA angle, which is supposed to be ideally 82 degrees, is increased in case of class 2 malocclusion. And for class 3, this angle is going to be decreased since the maxilla is retruded. Now the second one we have is SNB angle. Now instead of this A, we have the third point is our S, N and B, which is present in the mandible. So this angle, this relationship gives the idea of anterior positioning, anterior posterior positioning of the mandible in relation to the cranial base. So this angle, the average value is 80 degrees. This angle is formed by connecting point S, N and point B, which is our in the mandible. So this SNB angle increases. This angle will increase in case of class 3, wherein the maxilla mandible is protruded. Now the mandible is protruded and the mandible, the location of point B will be somewhere ahead of the normal location. So this angle is going to be increased for class 3. Definitely the third point has moved now. The point B has moved. In case of a protruded mandible, this angle is going to be greater. The SNB angle is going to be greater than 80 degree. And in case of a retruded mandible, for example, in class 2 relationship, this angle is going to be less than the normal value. Now coming to the third angle we have, which is ANB. ANB angle is formed by joining the point A, point N and point B. So we have point A. Let's remove the rest of the things. So we have point A, point N and point B. This angle normally is 2 degrees. See the difference, you can make out the difference. If you subtract SN A minus SN B, it will come to 2 degrees, of course. So this angle, the mean value is 2 degrees. Now this angle is increased. ANB angle is increased in case of class 2. Now the A is shifted here. So this angle is of course greater. If in case of a prognathic maxilla, if in case of a skeletal class 2 malocclusion, this ANB angle is increased. While in case of class 3, this angle is decreased. It will be less than 2 degrees. The fourth one we have is our mandibular plane angle. So the mandibular plane angle for Downs analysis, we had two points, gonion and menthon. For Steiner's analysis, the point are going to vary for the mandibular plane. We have studied in the plane video. So the points which we are going to take for mandibular plane is gonion to gnathion. Gnathion is a point which is formed by intersecting the menton and pogonion. So this is our gnathion. So the mandibular plane for Steiner analysis is gnathion to gonion. And the other one is our SN plane, because we are taking SN plane as our gold standard for Steiner analysis. For Downs analysis, it was the facial plane which was our NPOG. So SN plane and the mandibular plane. These two lines intersect, the angle formed is our mandibular plane angle. For Steiner analysis, the average value for mandibular plane angle is 32 degrees. Now this value again increase, it tells the growth pattern of an individual. This angle is going to be increased for a vertical grower. Since the growth pattern is vertically, so this angle is going to be greater for a vertical grower. This angle is going to be decreased for a horizontal grower patient. Now the occlusal plane angle is the line which connects the occlusal plane. So the line connecting the occluding surfaces of our molars, permanent molars and premolars, which extends anteriorly. This is our occlusal plane. The angle which is formed between the occlusal plane and the SN plane is our occlusion plane angle. This angle ideally or on an average is 14.5 degrees. Now this angle gives the relationship of the occlusal plane to the cranial base. And the another thing which this occlusion plane angle tells is the growth pattern of the individual. Now, if the patient is a vertical grower, this angle is going to be increased. If the patient is a horizontal grower, this angle is going to be decreased. So, this is our skeletal parameters. We have studied 5 parameters, SNA, SNB, SNA, which is increased for class 2, SNB, which is increased for class 3. The average value for SNA is 82 degrees. For SNB is 80 degrees. I don't have to again and again tell you this angle is formed by joining S point, N point and A point. And if you have not studied the anatomical landmark, please pause the video and watch the anatomical landmark so that you get the idea about all the anatomical landmarks in cephalometry. The SNB is 80 degrees. The ANB is subtracting both these. So it will get average of 2 degrees. ANB angle is increased for this point A has shifted forward. So this angle is increased for class 2 malocclusion. For the mandibular plane angle is the angle which is formed by intersecting the mandibular plane, which is gonion and gnathion for Steiner's, And our SN plane, this angle on an average is 32 degrees and it is increased for the vertical growers. The occlusal plane angle is an angle which is formed by connecting the occlusion plane formed by the occlusion plane and our SN plane. This angle on an average is 14.5 degrees and this angle is increased in a vertical grower patient. This gives the idea of growing pattern of a patient. Now coming to the dental parameters, we have 5 skeletal, 5 dental and 1 soft tissue parameter. The dental parameters are, the Steiner's analysis is a piece of cake, it's very easy. So the dental parameters are upper incisor to NA. See, A point is situated in the maxilla. So if we are talking about the upper incisor, we'll be talking about point A. And if we are talking about lower incisor, we'll be talking about point B. So the upper incisor to NA, the angle which is the formed between upper connecting the long axis of the upper incisor to NA, and the second one is upper incisor to NA linear is the measurement we'll be talking in detail. The lower incisor to NB, B point is present in the mandible. So point B to, in relation to the lower incisor to NB linear, the measurement, this is the angle, this is the measurement. And the fifth one is the interincisal angle. So the first one is upper incisor angle to NA angle. It is an angle which is formed by intersecting the long axis of our maxillary, central upper incisors and the lining joint and the line joining between N, the nasion, to point A. So this angle, once we extend it, the angle is formed between the long axis of the upper incisors, the central incisors, and the line joining from nasion to point A. Normal value for this angle is 22 degrees. Now, this angle gives the idea about the inclination of the central incisors, the upper incisor. This angle is going to be increased wherein the patient is having a proclined upper incisors. For example, class 2 division 1, wherein the angle is going to be greater as the upper incisors are proclined. So the upper incisor, the second one we have is our upper incisor to NA linear. That means this NA line, I'm going to extend it. So this is our NA. This is the point A. So this NA line, the upper incisor are extending. The measurement between the labial surfaces of the upper centrals and the line joining the nasion to point A. So this measurements give the idea about the upper incisor position. So this value normally is 4 millimeters. Now this value increases where the maxillary teeth are proclined, the upper centrals are proclined. So in case the upper central are proclined, this measurement is going to be bigger than, larger than 4 millimeters. So the third one we have is the lower incisor to NB. Now we will be connecting N to point B. The point B is located in the mandible. So this is our N to B. This is our point B. And so this angle is formed by joining the NB plane and the long axis of the mandibular central. Now we are talking about, since we are talking about point B which is in the mandible, so we are taking, this is, I'm making you easy to understand and easy to memorize. So this is our long axis of the lower central incisors. So this angle give about the inclination of the lower central incisor. Mean value for this angle is 25 degree, which is slightly greater than the upper incisors. This angle is increased. See, this is our mandibular central incisor. Now this angle is increased in case of the proclination of the lower incisor. Now the lower incisor are proclined. This angle is going to be greater than the normal, greater than 25 degrees, and this value is decreased wherein the mandibular incisor are upright placed or they are retruded lingually. So the next one we have is the lower incisor to NB linear. So this NB line is drawn from point N to point B, and the distance between the labial surfaces, see, this is our NB. So this is the measurement. The distance between the labial surfaces of the lower central incisor and the line joining from nasion to point B. This measurements gives about the idea of lower incisor inclination. Now, this angle is increased in cases of proclined lower incisors. So, in cases of class 3 malocclusion, this measurement is going to be bigger than 4 millimeters, which is the both the angles, the linear measurement is equal, the measurements is equal for maxilla and mandible. So from this line, if the 4 millimeter value is exceeding, that means the patient is having proclined lower anteriors, which is normally a case scenario in class 3 malocclusion. Now, the last one we have in dental parameters is our interincisal angle. This is an angle which is formed by joining the long axis of upper and the lower central incisors. So, this is our upper central incisor. This is our lower central incisor. So, this angle which is formed by joining the long axis of upper and lower central incisor is our interincisor. Inter means in between the incisor. So, this is the angle formed in between the incisor. For Steiner analysis, this angle is 130 degree. If you remember, we have studied interincisor angle. In the Downs analysis also, the average value was 130 to 150 degrees. And the mean value was 135.4 degrees. So, go back. If you have not read the Downs analysis, go back and read the Downs analysis. This interincisor angle is decreased. Now reduced in case of class 2 division 1. In case of bimaxillary proclination, where the teeth are proclined, wherein the teeth are proclined, this angle is going to be decreased, and this angle is increased or greater in case of class 2 division 1, where the central incisor are placed with palatally. So let's just go through all the 5 dental parameter. Upper incisor 2NA is 22 degrees. The mean value is upper incisor to NA linear. This is the measurement, which is normally 4 millimeters. Lower incisor to NB line, which is 25 degrees. Lower incisor to NB, the labial surfaces, the measurement is 4 millimeters. And the interincisor between the long axis is, the average is 130 degrees. So the third parameter we have is our soft tissue parameter in the Steiner analysis. According to Steiner, a S is formed by joining the lower border of the nose up to the lips. So this is a S, and this S line is a line which is drawn from the lips to the tip of the chin. So this tells the profile of the patient. Now if the lips are beyond this line, then lips are going to be protrusive. That means the patient is going to have a convex profile. And if the patient, if the lips are behind this line, then the lips are going to be retrusive. That means the lips are behind this line. So the patient is going to have a concave profile. So this finishes the soft tissue parameter and the Steiner's analysis. That's pretty much it. If you have any questions about the Steiner's analysis, leave it in the comment below. Give it a thumbs up if you like it. Make sure to subscribe to the channel if you haven't done it yet. And I'll see you next time.